Welcome, everyone, and thank you for joining us today. I'm Lee Gary of Corporate Counsel Business Journal, and today we are pleased to invite Sean Kelly from FTI Consulting and Jason Ward from Shook, Hardy & Bacon to present Data Privacy Implications of Cloud-Based Social Collaboration App. Before I turn the presentation over to Sean and Jason, I'd like to pass along a few tips to help you make the most of your experience today. I'd like to draw your attention first to a few of the icons on the bottom of your screen. The blue TV icon is for the presentation itself. If you mistakenly close the slide view, simply click on that widget and the slides will reappear. To make the slide view bigger, just click on the larger square on the top right corner of that window. You can also move and resize all the open windows on your screen. The purple Q&A icon allows you to submit questions during the presentation. To make the most of your time with us today, we do encourage you to ask questions. We'll do our best to address your questions during our presentation or at our Q&A session at the end, but if your specific questions are not answered, we will follow up with you individually. Also, if you're having any technical issues, feel free to submit your concern and we'll help you to resolve it. The blue silhouette icon offers the bio and contact information for today's subject matter experts. Please feel free to connect with them directly after this presentation. Finally, as a reminder, this presentation is being recorded and will be made available to all registrants for on-demand viewing. Thank you again for joining us today, and now I'll pass the mic to Sean to begin the presentation.
Thanks very much, Lainey. And good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for making time in your day to spend about an hour with us to talk about the data privacy implications of cloud-based social collaboration applications, specifically some pitfalls that you can look out for and some technology that you might be able to deploy with respect to getting ahead of any of those issues, as well as on the backside as it relates to collecting if you find yourself in a position that you need to do so. As Lainey mentioned, my name is Sean Kelly. I'm a senior director at FTI Consulting, and I'm part of our information governance, privacy, and security practice. I joined the firm about 3 years ago, and prior to that, I spent about 7 years in-house in a number of different roles, but primarily focusing on data discovery, data collection, and privacy implications of storing data, particularly sensitive data types. And I'm joined today by my colleague and friend Jason Ward from Shook, Hardy & Bacon, and I'll allow him to introduce himself as well.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone, and thank you, Sean. This is Jason Ward, and I am with Shook, Hardy & Bacon. I'm with the Data and Discovery Strategies Group here at Shook, and I have practiced in this discovery space for about 20 years. So happy to participate.
Thanks, Jason. We're certainly happy to have you. So a little bit about the problem that we're facing. I think it's one, you know, as Lainey introduced, and as I tried to summarize succinctly in my opening, you know, cloud-based applications are becoming increasingly more and more prevalent, and they are proliferating into the business, enterprise, and business network system with rapid frequency, in such that having a well-developed IT policy and a whitelist, blacklist type approach just doesn't seem to do the trick anymore. So with that in mind, we've kind of prepared this visual for you all, highlighting what the problem is, right? We've got personal devices, you know, such as laptops. This, of course, looks like a BlackBerry, which is a relic for most of us, as well as your typical office suite data types, such as Word, Excel, PowerPoint, PDF, mail files, et cetera. And then we have our legacy network storage and rack storage locations that, you know, many of us have become quite familiar with governing and protecting. But What's really at issue is all of this other stuff, which is the, you know, increase of folks moving to bring, you know, BYOD, you know, bringing their own device, as well as demanding more speed and more efficiency. And in doing so, they're attacking business challenges to work more efficiently, and that's creating what we're seeing on the screen now, which is the development and proliferation of all of these various applications that our colleagues and you know, knowledge workers are really using most of the time with best intentions to increase their efficiency or you know, find a way to collaborate in a way that's faster or you know, might take out unnecessary steps such as email or phone calls, text, etc. Jason, do you have any comments here?
Yeah, you know, this and the thing about this slide is it's just a sampling, right? I mean, we're limited by the space that we can display the applications, but this is just a portion of what we see clients grappling with day to day. And as you can imagine, the challenges that, you know, the IT and IS departments have in learning about these new applications, in determining how folks are using them, and then determining how they may have to collect from them and produce them in litigation, it's quite the challenge.
Yeah, that's certainly a good point there, Jason. And I think it's one that folks on the phone are probably pretty familiar with, because, you know, these applications are being developed and downloaded faster than corporate legal departments and corporate governance departments are really able to keep up. You know, even if we are very diligent in you know, searching trending technologies with respect to our specific business verticals, or even if we limited it, say, to messaging or project management or another efficiency type application, right? Storage, you know, even if you limited it to those three subgroups of applications, it would, you still would not be able to, on a daily basis, assess each and every individual application that's rolling onto the App Store, you know, both Android and iOS being very popular throughout the world. It's just something that is next to impossible, but it is something that through good policy, through governance and enforcement, that I think folks on the phone and folks that we work with, Jason, are really able to kind of advance the ball a bit and create some defensibility for their organizations in the way that they design their policies and processes.
No question.
So, you know, here are some interesting statistics. Well, they were interesting to us, at least. You know, and I don't think it'll be surprising to most that, you know, about 70% of the Fortune 500 have purchased or are adopting, you know, what Microsoft refers to as actively adopting Office 365, which represents, you know, a pretty massive growth. Interestingly for me was that Google Apps for Work has a pretty good share, you know, over 50% right there at 64 of Fortune 500. And when we clicked into that a little bit further, we began to find out that Google Apps for Work is a good platform for IT departments internally to build bespoke applications that they can safely push out to devices being managed, you know, managed devices. So that I think is where that adoption is. Last but certainly not least are the familiar Dropbox and Box with respect to records management and frankly records storage, with Dropbox having a much larger share here than Box, but Box certainly increasingly kind of on the heels there of Dropbox. Jason, did you have any thoughts here with respect to either Dropbox or Google Apps for work?
Well, I think you know the challenge that we have is it's difficult to control when folks are using these items. You have to make sure that you have directives in place for your staff and for IT to use with folks that may be using these applications, because if you don't, they're going to use them, and then you're going to have to, on the back end, figure out how to preserve the information and provide it as part of discovery. So I guess the first part is recognizing that they could be in play, making sure you have protocols for dealing with them, and then figuring out whether you want them in play at all or not.
Yeah, I think that's certainly a point well taken there. This illustration, and apologies as it might be a bit busy or small on your screen, but we found this particularly interesting when we were doing research for today's discussion. This breaks down the share of platform time spent by age group, and the colors that you see represented there in blue, orange, greenish blue, red, and purple relate to desktop PCs, smartphone applications, smartphone web browsers, tablet applications, or tablet web browser, respectively. So when I'm kind of taking a look at this data as it relates to the kind of typical or most frequent age buckets for workers, kind of that 18 through 64 there, you see that an overwhelming majority of time is being spent on their smartphone or on their tablet in one way or another, predominantly within an application, which I think is interesting in itself. But also interestingly, or interesting to note, is the smartphone and tablet web figures, because I think this figure might represent for us, in some instances, areas where knowledge workers are logging into web-based systems or information repositories that they otherwise might have done on a desktop, and there's of course the potential for data loss as well as inadvertent disclosure, and the obvious, of course, skipping two-factor authentication. Setting that aside, Jason, what are your kind of just gut reactions here when you see, these age groups in the 25 to 34, 35 to 44, and then 45 to 54, all at or almost at 50% of their time is being spent in an application doing work rather than on their desktop or PC?
Well, I think it's a pretty clear indication as to the manner in which folks are working and communicating. I think it's a great slide to maybe get the folks that are working on these systems as it relates to litigation going and thinking about how we're going to capture this, how we're going to preserve it, how we're going to comply with discovery requests. I couldn't help but I was looking at the slide and chuckling to myself. I wonder what the sales team numbers would be, as I suspect they would be greater than the 18 to 24 app usage. But that's just personal experience, I guess. But it's a great slide, and I think it really puts into context where we should be focusing our efforts in, as far as learning how to deal with how users are working within our systems and what we need to do to preserve and comply.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And I also think it would be interesting to see, a breakdown maybe from ComScore in their next iteration of this research. To your point, what would it look like for sales specifically? And I suspect for certain companies or even certain business verticals that rely heavily on a field-based sales force, for their company specifically, you're likely to see, even higher, smartphone app and smartphone web app utilization, which would be an interesting survey to conduct internally. That way you can better understand what your company's individual or specific risk might be as it relates to collaboration applications and smartphone and tablet usage. Similarly to, some of the other platforms that we talked about, here are some other very common platforms that Jason and his colleagues and myself and my colleagues are seeing more and more on the side of collection than we had in years past. We've been working diligently with clients both to have a defensible and robust policy for collecting that information, but also to have policies in place for the users, for the business users that are interacting with these platforms. And then last but not least, which we'll get to, is that third-party contracting piece of the puzzle, which is critically important here, particularly as it relates to a third party storing your data and having access to your data. Slack is very similar to Microsoft Teams, and it is kind of a scrolling social interface for users, particularly teammates, to keep a conversation going, for the better part of a workday, or even for a project. You can start a Slack channel that could be, titled "Today's Webcast." And Jason and I are slacking on, with comments on what we think, where we should go next, right? Or you could have a Slack channel that could exist for months or even years that could be viewed by an entire department or more. That could be related to a kind of change the organization project, and those are the types of instances or use cases that we want to become more familiar with, right? We want to make sure that we are working with our business units and understanding what our individual teammates, right, the folks in the business, what do they need? And once we understand that need, kind of building the policy and the process to support that, because I'm sure we've all been the unfortunate person that gets told, "Oh, well, you all just tell us no," and I don't think any of us really want to be in that position, right? We want to give good advice. We want to protect the company and protect the shareholders, but we want to also enable our business customers and colleagues to do good work and do it efficiently, because as we all know, efficiency increases productivity, and increased productivity leads to an increase in revenue. So things like Slack, Trello, Evernote, and of course it should come as no surprise here, Salesforce becoming more and more popular. Originally Salesforce was predominantly a CRM tool. And it kind of became the CRM tool. And since then, with their SaaS model, they have become very agile and adaptive to the needs of their clients and have made very bespoke instances for companies to use Salesforce in a number of different ways that is not just for, client relationships or for sales forecasting. Jason, do you have any comments here, particularly, maybe weigh in on your thoughts as it relates to the contracting or the procurement phase, making sure that legal's got a seat at the table, or kind of early on there?
You bet. That's really important when working with third-party hosting services. One of the challenges that we run into is a lot of the ways that these third parties work with data, hosted data, is proprietary, and so you get into a situation where you're collecting from those third-party hosted databases. And you need a specific export, and in order to have that export, you have to work with Salesforce, or you have to work with one of these other third-party providers. And so having that discussion up front and knowing what that's going to take in order to export information on the back end is critical, and understanding what the timeline is going to be when you're in situations where you need to move fast. So it's great to have those discussions early. Eyes wide open, and be prepared for what the pain points are during collection time.
It's great advice, and I'll just add to that it's important, and the reason we're highlighting some of these kind of frequent flyers here is because these applications were developed by engineers who are not necessarily thinking about corporate challenges, and they're certainly not thinking about data privacy. Not only are they not thinking about data privacy, but they're not thinking about specific data privacy regulations, such as jurisdictional issues with respect to where the data is located, is the data commingled with sensitive data types, et cetera. So, making sure that a member of the privacy team is involved in the what I'll call the approval phase, right? In kind of selecting these individual applications that might be more broadly adopted, I think is very critical, because you don't want to have a group or perhaps even an entire business segment that's using Salesforce, and the data tenant is located in a jurisdiction that might not necessarily be where you as an organization would prefer that data to sit for a number of different reasons, whether it's regulatory risk or other. And I think that overarching theme of social collaboration applications, or really any application, maybe with the exception of some of the more sophisticated Microsofts, et cetera, they're typically not designed with privacy in mind. So this more recent principle of privacy by design is something that we kind of have to insert ourselves into the process and start to ask questions of our IT counterparts and make sure that there's agility with these kind of applications that are more widely adopted to implement some data privacy best practices, right? Such as being able to segregate data, being able to respond to a data subject access request in a reasonable time frame. As Jason mentioned, making sure you get ahead of that in the procurement and contracting piece is pretty critical, because if you get a request under GDPR or not too far off under CCPA, there's a timeline that's going to be connected to it, and you want to make sure that you as an organization are protected, and that you have a service level agreement with these third parties that are hosting your data. So here we're just kind of summing up what the problem truly is, and that's that, as I mentioned, knowledge workers and frankly just all of us generally want more speed, more flexibility, and more control over the way that we interact with our data, and sometimes in the way that we do our job. And that creates challenges for us as privacy executives or in Jason's case, as a legal officer. some important points, I think, to mention here is that in our research, where we were gathering information from a number of sources, including Gartner, workers were consistently polling or telling folks that they're disappointed that the legacy applications or kind of those whitelisted applications, you know, drag them down or limit their productivity because they're too old or, you know, they don't have the features and functionality that they might be used to in some of these newer applications that they're using in their personal life. Most critically, you know, the collaboration across an enterprise is being transformed, at an incredibly rapid rate. And it's really at the nexus of mobility, social exchanges, cloud storage, and data location. And when I say social exchanges, you know, that in this context, I don't want to limit that to, you know, Facebook or Instagram, but also to the social applications or even chatter that a user might not think is a business record because of the collegial or social way in which they create that record, that it is indeed a business record in most instances, and depending upon the data type and frankly what the content of that message is, that data could be sensitive or protected. Interestingly here, and Jason, happy to get your thoughts here. This kind of was a bit of a shock to me that Gartner projects that more than 300 billion mobile applications are being downloaded from the mobile app stores every year. So work is really shifting from on your laptop at your desk to on your iPhone and on your tablet. And I think it's really giving us an opportunity in the privacy and legal professions to demonstrate and bring value to our business colleagues in helping them get ahead of that in as it relates to policy and process. You know, we keep mentioning that. Jason, I've been rambling. Do you have thoughts here, particularly on the 300 billion apps being downloaded?
Well, you know, I think that's a number that when you look at it, you're thinking, how could I possibly deal with that on a company level with the number of different apps that the employees could possibly be using? And you know, we've said it a couple times already today that the first place that you deal with it is through policy. If you get into a position within litigation where you're having to talk about what your business practices have been, what your rules have been as it relates to a particular application, and whether those applications should be used to create business records. That's where it starts. So for me, it goes back to what are the rules, and you establish a very solid set of rules as it relates to the use of those applications, and then working collaboratively across the business units to talk about, okay, what do we really need to be using for business purposes, and how can we incorporate that into our policies and make sure that we have coverage for that? But then once it goes beyond those particular applications, we just need to be able to point back to our policy and know that that's where home base is. And I think that's how folks have dealt with it thus far. It's continuing to evolve. I say that with a little bit of a disclaimer that we may have to change course, but that's certainly how we've tried to approach it. And I think for most of the courts that are addressing it, that makes a lot of sense. You can't really be in a position from a company standpoint of playing whack-a-mole with these applications if it's not your intent to use them for a business purpose. So to me, that's the starting point.
Great advice, Jason. So kind of just summarizing the problem we're facing here, apologies for that, you know, that knowledge workers want speed and flexibility, which is, you know, technical diversity plus the workplace challenges of mobility and the lines being blurred between professional data as well as personal data, it kind of leads to this lack of corporate control. And that lack of corporate control is really where IT and legal departments get very, very anxious and very uneasy because they start to lose control of their data universe. Because you know with those applications and the way that they're designed, users can easily move and share or even delete data, and oftentimes collection tools are not keeping pace. With the speed in which these applications are kind of rolling online. Jason, do you want to speak to, you know, part of the problem here being that legal requirements, including privacy regulations, just not being a priority for application developers and kind of what that means for us and for our corporate clients?
Yeah, so that's a big challenge. Because, you know, as we can explain what the current environment is and lay out a great picture of this to the courts, they may sympathize with that and they may realize that it's a challenge, but I think they're going to be hard-pressed to relieve the burden of preserving and producing relevant information. So while we have these developers that aren't thinking along those same lines and putting us in a position to preserve and collect data, I don't think from the court's perspective they're going to be able to limit liability in that instance. And so it really provides a very difficult challenge. And I think it's one that is going to continue to rear its head because of the way that apps are being developed. I think within the discovery space and within the litigation space, we need to continue to lobby for the use of applications that have a back end that allows us to defensively preserve and collect. For those that don't, we need to come up with explanations of why they don't, why it would be too burdensome for us to make that happen, and why we may be able to get the same data in other places. So that's, you know, when we come to a dead end as it relates to particular applications, that's typically where we point, and hopefully there is an opportunity to retrieve the same or similar data somewhere else.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point, Jason, particularly as it relates to, you know, archiving, frequently with respect to records management and even privacy by design to a certain extent for internal applications, we've come to a sense of security with respect to system archives and vaults, but that's something that we don't have with this kind of changing, shifting landscape of applications that are being able to download, pardon me, for folks to use freely. This might be a good time, Jason, for us to talk about some of the case law that we're seeing currently.
Yeah, absolutely. We've listed a number of cases here that touch on some of our topics, and I want to be mindful of our time, so I'm not going to walk through every one of them. We provided the case citations and a brief description of the holdings for everyone, but I'm going to highlight a few of these, and we're seeing more and more cases that address social media, and a lot of the cases have originated in personal injury settings where you have someone who is alleging various injuries and so their medical records and, you know, frankly, their social media discussions and portrayal of their lifestyle is put on case. And so while we see that in the personal injury context, we're also now seeing more and more of it in mass tort settings. So for years and years, folks that operate on the defense side didn't have the opportunity, I think, that they have now as it relates to discovery of social media in some of these mass tort settings. So for me, it's provided some nice reading. It may unfortunately provide a glimpse into my daily life and getting my entertainment from reading. But some of them are quite entertaining, and I'd like to share a few of them with you. So the Foreman v. Hinken case that you see, let's see. Slide here. The Foreman v. Hinken case that you see there was a plaintiff that alleged personal injuries resulting from a fall off of defendant's horse. And they had a Facebook account that purportedly contained photos relating to plaintiff's post-fall lifestyle. And the defendant obviously was interested in those photos. Plaintiff claimed that the content had been made private and that discovery of such would be an invasion of privacy. And this is one that we see quite frequently for folks who aren't schooled in every practice, is that the social media settings are important to them. But I think what we're seeing in most courts is that they disagree. And in this setting, the court did disagree and held that when plaintiffs commenced this action relating to physical injuries, they put those items on record. And so whether something was maintained in the public instance or the private instance of Facebook, those social media posts were going to be discoverable. Another case that was interesting here is the Kelter v. Flanagan case. In this situation, it was another case where a plaintiff had alleged injuries from an auto accident. The plaintiff maintained a public Instagram account and did so through the time of their deposition. And during the deposition, the defense shared photos and posts from the Instagram account that clearly were relevant and related to the alleged injuries and the activity after the accident. And immediately preceding the deposition, the plaintiff flipped the account to private and made the point that the defendants had an opportunity to view the account while it was public, and that any further discovery of the account shouldn't be allowed because it was now private. And as you might imagine, the court disagreed and provided access to those private settings as well. Additional case that I wanted to talk about was the G versus Citizens Insurance. This is one in where the plaintiff had received numerous requests related to social media and had even received orders from the court that they needed to preserve their social media and they needed to produce it. The defendants, as part of their due diligence, found evidence that the plaintiff had deleted a number of the historical posts on Facebook and raised that with the court. The court immediately dismissed the case as a sanction for those deletions, and the appellate court upheld that. That one to me was just black and white. And even outside of the social media context, if someone is going to go so far as to intentionally disobey an order of the court, I think we know what the consequences are going to be. But, in the social media context, I think folks operate so freely in social media, perhaps they don't take it quite as seriously as they should. But in this instance, the sanction was a dismissal of the case.
That's good advice, okay. Jason. And I think it kind of highlights for us, what we often see early on with respect to case law, particularly in self-injury, is something that we can draw parallels to, in corporate defense later on down the line. And what we're really seeing is that, there should be no expectation of privacy, particularly as it relates to these more common social media platforms, and certainly as it relates to corporations when they are public accounts. As Jason's likely to get into here, that then becomes a question of possession, custody, and control that you want to make sure that your marketing teams and your digital and social teams that are managing these accounts and creating these accounts, have the appropriate role-based access controls such that they cannot delete something where as a corporation you might find yourself in a sticky situation. Not to steal your thunder, there's Jason, I'm sure you want to highlight a couple of these cases.
Yeah, no, those are great points, Sean. One actually that does go to possession versus control is the Matthews versus J&J Services Solutions case. In that case, a plaintiff brought the case alleging employment discrimination and retaliatory discharge. She claimed that her dismissal was retaliatory due to her attempts to report misconduct by her supervisor. The defendants, which were the company that employed the supervisor, served discovery on plaintiffs seeking archived social media content and, importantly, I think here, provided a step-by-step instruction as to how plaintiffs could retrieve that information, export it, and produce it. And as part of the response, the plaintiff said that information was not in their possession, and that they had no duty to provide it as they didn't have access to the information. It was being hosted by a third-party provider. The court really didn't address the possession issue, but said it was clearly in plaintiff's control, and defendants had provided step-by-step instructions for how it could be accessed, exported, and produced. And so in this instance, you see the difference between possession, personal possession versus control as it relates to third-party social media platform. And I think we're going to find pretty routinely that will be the case, as Facebook certainly has a way to export your data, and many social media platforms do. And so while you may escape the possession piece, I think you're gonna have problems with the control piece, and they did have it in this instance. Sean, any thoughts in that regard?
No, I think you're hitting the nail right on the head, and I want to be mindful here of time so that we can open the line up to questions for folks that they don't have to hear us kind of yammering on here the whole time. Some additional considerations, of course, include ethics, the Stored Communications Act, as well as the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, particularly Rule 26B limits, to discovery due to burden. That's a tough one. I think Jason would agree there. And then also the authentication and use, probably more importantly for this group, are the privacy considerations. This list has two bullet points, but it really could have had 20. Top of mind, or at least top of tip of the tongue for most people these days, are GDPR or the California Consumer Protection Act. But we also have industry specific regulations such as New York State's DFS Rule 500 that governs the way that specific data is maintained. Interestingly, the expectations for disposition of that data towards the end of its life cycle, and what the Department of Financial Services deems as necessary. So I think we're going to continue to see privacy become more and more important as an element of our everyday business, but specifically as it relates to the applications that we whitelist or kind of give blessing to our organization's, you know, broad use or adoption. Next up on our agenda is kind of talking through the process a bit, and I don't want to spend too much time here. You know, as I mentioned, we're kind of showing you where data sits within an organization based on the information governance reference model. You know, in a number, you know, essentially five places: the profit center in the business, risk centers or monitoring risk centers such as privacy and security, areas that drive efficiency such as IT or HR, records and information management, and then controls such as legal. And then with pardon me, within that, as you can see on the page, we've tried to kind of list out all of the areas that can come into play in any one of these kind of pieces of the pie. But having a cross-functional team from each of these areas in the business, in privacy, in IT, in legal, in records and information management, that are at the ready to respond to questions from the business or questions from the board, or you know, even on a something as simple as what should the process be to do a release enhancement for a specific application or piece of software. All of these ancillary activities such as change management, breach response, data migration, legal hold, you know, that's a big one, all come into play, and you really need a number of subject matter experts within the organization that are aligned and working together to kind of get this right. Jason, any thoughts here?
Just simply to say that I love the slide. I mean, it's for anyone who thinks there's an easy button as it relates to information governance and any related discovery, this is a fantastic slide.
Appreciate that. So, finalizing with respect to the process, some pieces of advice here. Making sure that you have an acceptable use policy that specifically calls out social media and other networking applications is of critical importance, and that's why it's the first bullet. Related to that is be realistic. You know, set expectations for your end users that are attainable and that are not idealistic, because at the end of the day, you're going to be held to in some cases, your own standard. And if your own standard is too onerous or too idealistic, you've done yourself a disservice. So understanding the culture of the organization, the idiosyncrasies of the business units that are using these applications are all critically important. As Jason and I mentioned previously, kind of having that, you know, cross-functional collaboration between different groups and stakeholders within the company, IT, compliance, e-discovery collection team, procurement or sourcing, business leadership. If you have a DPO, I would say certainly include that individual in this list as well. And then next, aligning your IG policies to account for those third-party applications that are going to host or store your organization's information, and being mindful of privacy when you're creating that policy or when you're updating that policy, including best practices for privacy by design and not, you know, privacy by response, is I think best approach there. Starting to bake it into the way that you do business instead of, you know, being on your heels and responding to a data subject request. And then last, but, you know, certainly not least, is select the right applications. Make sure you're working together to select applications that fit your company's risk tolerance. You know, and just a quick example here, and Jason, I'll invite you to comment, but, you know, in some of our more highly regulated industries, they're quite risk averse as it relates to data security and governance. So, you know, the way that they might approach, you know, kind of a white list, so to speak, is very different than perhaps a smaller privately held tech startup, for example. Jason, any comments there?
You bet. Absolutely. That decision needs to be informed by folks across the business units. So it needs to be an understanding for why certain applications are needed, what the regulatory and litigation risk is, and a eyes wide open decision made by a collaboration of all those folks.
Great. Next, we kind of highlighted a case study example from Dropbox that includes an analysis of how the collection went, as well as kind of what are the questions to ask yourself. You know, we won't spend time kind of going through each of these as it is just an hour we have together, but we can certainly share this example with folks, or if folks would like the slide pack, we're happy to do that as well. You know, I kind of think the gist of it here is that analyzing the need and reaching alignment with the impacted parties, whether that's you know, outside counsel if you're in litigation, whether that's an internal business unit if it's an internal investigation, or whether it's a regulator, you know, having an agreement on what the output should look like and understanding what you need up front before you begin, you know, kind of sketching out that collection methodology is imperative. And then, of course, of utmost importance, being mindful of your privacy obligations with respect to the data types that are in that specific application or that specific database. Making sure if, for example, there's sensitive data, that you're anonymizing it if required or if necessary, and using best privacy practices there. Jason, any comment here, you know, particularly on the collection side? And I know you've done a lot of work helping clients create defensible collection and ESI protocols. Any comment here, war story?
Well, I want to leave some time for questions, so I'll leave out the war stories. But, you know, I think as we've talked today about a lot of the evolving applications, part of our job is to come up with defensible ways to describe the preservation, collection, and production from those applications. And because some of them are so nuanced and unfamiliar, it may be something that we have to incorporate into a teaching session, either with the court or in a meet and confer setting with other counsel. We just need to be in a position that we can defensively describe that information and not be forced into a leveraged position on the back end where that information isn't clear and hasn't been shared up front.
That's great advice. So I think, you know, let's here, just being mindful of folks' time, going to kind of move along to some questions. And I see from our moderator that we already have a few questions. But Caitlin or Lainey, if you could explain to folks how they can submit a question if they have one, we'd certainly appreciate it.
Sure, I'll hop on here. If anyone has a question, they can go ahead and submit that through Q&A. The ones that we've already received, we're going to push through to you guys, and you can answer, you know, depending on the time. Any questions that aren't answered, we will have you guys circle back directly with whoever's asking the question. And if anyone wants a copy of the slides, go ahead and just put that request in the Q&A box as well. There's a little icon on the bottom of your screen. You just click that and just say, can I have a copy of the slides? And we'll be able to get those out to you. So I'm going to stop talking so you can get back to some questions before we run out of time.
Thanks. Thanks very much. So it looks like we've already got a few questions here. So Jason, the first question we're seeing is, what are some key components of a third-party data protection policy? So I think we covered a little bit of this earlier on as it relates to partnering with procurement, as well as making sure that you have a stake at the table as it relates to data jurisdiction, data ownership, et cetera. But apart from that, I think for me at least, making your policy enforceable and having some sort of action that the privacy team or the compliance team can take, with an individual, whether it's a procurement officer or an individual business user who's, rogue contracting something, so that there is an enforcement element to give your policy teeth. Jason, do you have any thoughts on that one?
Yeah, and I would also add that we should always look at the confidentiality provisions of those agreements. We want to know that the data is secure from a business perspective, just day to day. We also want to have some pretty concrete language as it relates to what should happen if that third party provider is subpoenaed. So those are important things to think about.
A really good point. It's a really good point. Another question we received is, what are some strategies to encourage and or standardize cross-functional collaboration? So I think, again, great question. Thank you for that. And I think encouraging cross-functional collaboration, you can do in a number of ways. The first way is implementing an approval process that includes the privacy office or the chief compliance office, wherever privacy might fit, into the approval queue for budgeting. So that's kind of encouraging through an iron fist, but there's other ways too. Kind of building those cross-functional teams or committees, so to speak, so that you're really getting to know your colleagues in the business who are going to be having these requests, so that you're not getting it, getting brought in at the last minute, but rather, Mary in marketing is going to give me a call and say, hey, what do you think about this? And then you have, a quick chat about it, reach alignment, bring it to the committee, and kind of move on from there. Jason, what are your thoughts there? Do you think I'm off base or?
No, that makes a lot of sense. And I think it's important to have folks across the business involved in critical decisions. The other way that I've seen information shared is by a company intranet site. So to the extent you can push it out there in folks that, two things that folks are seeing on an everyday basis makes a lot of sense. We've also done frequently asked questions as it relates to privacy issues or litigation hold issues, things like that. Just ways to share that information in places that folks are going to every day.
That's a great point. Yeah. So lastly, we probably just have time for one more question. What that is what can I do from a policy perspective to protect my organization from the use of unauthorized IT? Ooh, the ever popular shadow IT question. I think most immediately what comes to mind for me is having a well-developed mobile device management policy, as well as acceptable use policies, and then running tabletop exercises where you're testing, you know, in real time what applications are on your network and on your device, and then remediating, you know, kind of as necessary. I recognize that we are, you know, out of time, and I want to thank you all for spending part of your afternoon with us, or morning for folks on the West Coast. We certainly appreciate it, and personally, I want to extend a very warm thank you to Jason for his partnership here in presentation. If you all have any follow-up questions, as Caitlin and Lainey mentioned, our contact information is available, and we're certainly happy to pass along this slide pack. So thank you very much for your time, everyone, and have a great afternoon.
Thanks, Sean, for wrapping that up so nicely. I'm just going to hop on real quick also to thank our audience for attending, and just remind everyone that within the next few days, you'll receive a link to the recorded event. And we hope you found this presentation informative, and we look forward to having you join us at our next event. Thanks so much, and enjoy the rest of your day. Bye-bye, everybody.
Thanks, all.